Good evening and welcome to Arizona Horizon. I'm Ted Simons. Arizona has joined 23 other states in an effort to get the federal government to pay its debts. The campaign to fix the debt is a nonpartisan effort to get the nation on better fiscal footing. Joining me to talk about the organization and its goals are former Attorney General Terry Goddard and fellow Arizona Chapter Steering Committee member Glenn Hammer, president of the Arizona Chapter Chamber, I should say, of Commerce and Industry. Good to have you both here. Thanks for joining us.
Great to be back.
The campaign to fix the debt. What are we talking about here?
Well, it seems a little intimidating to be on the same panel as the doomsday clock, so maybe we can draw an analogy. We're truly in uncharted and dangerous territory in terms of the financial condition of the country, and it's something that requires a focused political solution, and we're not getting it. We basically went off the fiscal cliff, and it was a bump. But unfortunately, what we see now is the can's just been kicked down the road, that many of the decisions have been put off to the discussion in probably February or March of the debt ceiling change, which is going to have to come up before Congress. And this is, frankly, an untenable situation for business and for our country, because we can't just keep playing with the economy of the United States. It needs to be the thing I'm so worried about is that Moody's and the other rating agencies are going to get in gear here, and without telling anybody, they're going to downgrade the debt, increasing the costs of running the government of the United States, and that's not an acceptable solution. So we're trying to come together and say, time to stop the gridlock, time to make a bipartisan, statesman-like answer to how do we move forward in a fiscally responsible way.
Indeed, that seems like the campaign is to fix the debt. You mentioned kicking the can down the road. What constitutes not kicking the can down the road?
Well, getting something done far beyond what was just passed in Congress to avert the fiscal cliff. I mean, that effort failed to do anything significant to deal with this problem. I mean, we're talking about you'll be talking about a doomsday clock. We're $16 trillion in debt. We're running annual trillion-dollar deficits. It's not sustainable. And at some point, that doomsday clock will go off in terms of our national economy. And here's the thing, Ted. We don't know when it will go off, but it will go off unless we take real action to get this situation under control.
And we hear these arguments a lot. Obviously, the campaign, the Arizona chapter, is now up and running, and yet there are some lawmakers who either don't see the seriousness or who take a different view and say, go ahead, let it blow up, and then we'll pick up the pieces later.
Well,
there are those of us who'd rather not face that future because this is the time for... If people want to be leaders in this country, and theoretically Congress has volunteered for that role, it's time for them to accept some responsibility. And frankly, as Glenn just said, they in the so-called dealing with the fiscal cliff, they basically blinked, made a couple of minor adjustments, passed it off for another time. And we can't continue to do that. The president has called for some resolution, and... Congress needs to shoulder some responsibility, and it's going to have to take both parties. The way we're divided, House and Senate, Republican and Democrat, now's the time for statesmanship and for courage, and we didn't see it in the last go-round.
And there are blueprints out there. This whole effort really stems from, it follows the effort of the Simpson-Bowles plan, which was a bold plan to trim trillions of dollars from our federal debt. There are models, and it's going to take tax reform. It's going to take a lot in terms of spending reform and getting our entitlements into a place where they're sustainable.
But I mentioned, picking up the pieces later, a bit of hyperbole there, but there are some who said, go ahead and fall off the cliff. There are others who say, we're just not going to mess with this debt limit anymore. How do you convince those folks that this is serious business?
We need to keep there's no way to fix this problem if the economy tanks. I mean, economic growth will make all of the other solutions much easier. I mean, it's still going to take a lot in terms of entitlement reform. It's going to take tax reform. But that job becomes much more difficult if we go back into a recession. And here's the good news, Ted. I mean, you've got major CEOs that are part of this campaign. And why are they part of this? Because there are hundreds of billions, there may be as much as $2 trillion of capital from leading corporations that's on the sidelines, And some of that capital will come off the sidelines once there's a sense that the United States has its fiscal house in order.
That's a really good point.
Can you get the house in order, though, when the two sides of the house seem so far apart on entitlement reform, seem so far apart on just the general nature of taxes?
Well, it's true. I mean, right now you've got no dialogue. You've got a group of people throwing up the non-negotiable demand of, as you say, on one side entitlements, on the other side taxes. It's going to take some of both. I mean, nobody thinks we're going to get out of this easily. It was a response to an economic crisis that created much of this problem. And I think we're going to have to find a, again, I hate to keep belaboring the bipartisan, there's pain for both sides here, but I really think that's the kind of program we need. And maybe the corporate community will be able to badger Congress into taking some action. What we saw the last time was an abdication of responsibility. It was nobody wanted to stand up and say, hey, maybe I won't be as pure to my followers as I used to be, but I need to find a solution that works for the country, not something which meets a certain ideological litmus test. And we used to have that kind of attitude in Congress. It's time we had it again.
How do you get that kind of attitude? How does a group like Fix the Debt, how does that push that kind of attitude onto congressional delegations?
Members of Congress listen to business leaders, and I believe getting this out of the realm of some of the hardened ideological positions of both parties is difficult to do. But business leaders have a way of communicating with members of both parties that's a little bit different than perhaps the grassroots. And again, I think members of both parties, they want to see a robust economy. I mean, probably the surest ticket to re-election is a healthy economy. I mean, and when the economy is going well and we have things humming, usually people in office do well. And the point here is if we don't get the House in order, at some point that doomsday clock is going to go off. And the repercussions for those in office, I believe, will be very severe.
And for those you referred to at the beginning that just say, well, let it fail. They don't know what they're talking about. I mean, basically saying, okay, let's run into recession, depression, and then, as Glenn has mentioned, you don't have the tax revenues, you don't have the wherewithal to deal with this huge problem. And that's simply irresponsible. That's not what national leaders ought to be talking about. And so let's fix it. Let's not talk about, sort of letting it go. It doesn't work.
The idea that this is a bipartisan or nonpartisan effort, New York Times had a story saying that the board has deep ties to the financial industry and business industries that have been pushing for corporate tax breaks for quite a while. Yeah. Is it heavy on that side? And B, does it have to be heavy on that side?
Well, it seems a little heavy on that side when I look at the list of major players here, but nonetheless, as Glenn said, there's a self-interest factor which needs to be tied in. If these folks feel, as many of them have already signed up, I mean, when the administration talked about saying, well, the top earners need to pay a higher level of the responsibility of paying for this country, an awful lot of CEOs showed up in Washington and said, that's right. We support that plan because we believe, in fact, this is an economy that's been hugely good to us. We're gonna pay a higher share. That's part of this dialogue. Another part is, let's say, there's been a lot of talk about earmarks. There's been a lot of talk about special interest boondoggles in the various budgets. I think it's an absolute abomination that this one had huge numbers of little pork items, $100 million, I believe, for moving a rum distillery from Puerto Rico to the Virgin Islands. We don't have time to play with those kind of ridiculous games. And it seems to me if we're going to work about fixing the economy, fixing the deficit in the budget, we've got to basically clear the deck for these special interest exceptions, which people seem to feel are always in order. They're not.
And if you look at the business leaders engaged in this effort, there are Republicans, there are Democrats. And let's face it, the political people in Congress have failed. So it's a positive injection to have very well-respected business leaders stand up and say, we need to get something done. And we need to get it done now, and it needs to be a meaningful effort.
So for someone watching this right now saying this is all fine and dandy, what are you going to do? I ask you, what are you going to do?
Well, we're very fortunate when we have distinguished people like our former Attorney General Terry Goddard, our Speaker of the House Andy Tobin. They don't see eye to eye in every issue. But when you have some of the adults in the room, particularly on the state level, screaming to our friends in Congress and in the White House, we need to get something done, I believe, I'm bullish that our friends in Congress will listen and get something done.
And ultimately, it's voters. These folks are accountable every 2 years, at least the ones in the House are, to the voters of this country. And they need to hear from them, too. So I don't think you can simply say, oh, the responsibility is now gone to a group of a bipartisan group who have great intentions. People need to write their congressmen. They need to get seriously engaged on this because it is that important for the future of this country.
Last word.
And you've got about 10,000 Arizonans that have signed the Fix the Debt petition, over 300,000 nationwide. So the general public is getting engaged, Ted.
All right. Very good. Good to have you here. Thanks for joining us. We appreciate it.
Thank you.